3 years ago, Czech national Petr Jasek was arrested for his work serving persecuted Christians in Sudan. Falsely imprisoned for conspiracy, spying, and inciting violence against the state, this is the Petr Jasek story.
Since the country of Sudan split into two countries, we've been monitoring the situation in northern Sudan as soon as possible. I decided to visit the country in December 2015, basically to document the reported persecution cases of individuals as well as the whole churches. Most likely the Sudanese security was following me after I accomplished everything what I wanted to, and I wanted to leave the country. I got arrested, and apparently the Sudanese authorities viewed me as a spy, and that's why they arrested me and started to interrogate me, put me in prison, and I spent 14 and a half months in various prisons in Sudan. It was a hard time for me because the secret police also didn't want me to contact my family or the embassy for a period of 1 month, so I went on a hunger strike, which actually even caused me to be much weaker than before. They also discovered that I was heavily anemic, limited by space, by movement, being attacked by the Islamists, and struggling with my own weakness, and I was literally praying that the Lord will keep my mind sound, because that was a very difficult time, and I was barely able to remember some of the scriptures that I memorized as a young boy. But the Lord, through the Holy Spirit, kept revealing me passages from scripture that gave me strength and hope for every day or for every week. The ISIS guys that I was put in the prison, same prison cell with, they were very violent. They started to limit my freedoms of movement in the cell while they were praying or whilst they were reading Quran. And later on they started to slander me with bad words and then even attack physically, slapping my face or hitting my face with their fists, or then later on even kicking my back. Eventually they decided to do the waterboarding on me, and when I was getting ready for that, they were questioning me with various questions concerning the Christian faith. But for me that was a great opportunity also to share the gospel with them. On May 19th, 2013, about 2.5 years before I got arrested in Sudan, I had a dream. In that dream, I saw the prison door being locked behind me, and I remember the color of the door, thickness of the door, and the size of the window of the door that was locked behind me. When I ended up, after almost 24 hours of interrogation, when I ended up in the prison cell and I heard the click of the thick door, yellowish-white color with a window that size, I clearly remembered that dream. I stopped blaming myself whether I did something wrong, whether I should have rewrite the deleted space in my memory card in my camera, but I started to think that the Lord has shown me this, what was supposed to come later in my life. When I was the first 4 months in prison, I was praying that the Lord would release me and to return me to my family. But later on, when I realized that the Lord had a different purpose for me in prison, to share the gospel, I stopped praying to be released. We knew that the Lord will open the doors of our prison cell one day. But we were so excited from the fact that we were able to preach the gospel to the hopeless people in prison. And that gave us such a joy, such a fulfillment, knowing that even though we were counted to be like the worst criminals, bound in chains, and when I say in chains, I mean really in chains, but the word of God was not bound because we were able to preach the gospel there. I used to send text messages from any airport where I landed. On that day, there was no text message from me to my wife. She started to worry. It was obvious to her that something happened. I have a wedding ring, but that's not the original one that I put on my finger on April 6, 1990. When I was with the ISIS fighters, they said, "You give us your wedding ring, you give us the gold." So I lost my ring. At first, I saw it like a kind of like a tragedy, you know. When I was released, then we exchanged the new wedding rings. It was a wonderful opportunity to thank the Lord for that our marriage, our experience was deepened through this period of suffering and separation. When I was meeting persecuted Christians who have not only lost their houses, their jobs, but those who have lost their beloved ones, or those even who lost parts of their bodies because they did not deny Christ, I have learned from those Christians that they consider the opportunity to suffer for Christ's name as a privilege. And of course, they explain their theology from, let's say, Philippians 1:29, when Paul says it has been granted to you as a privilege not only to believe in Christ, but also to suffer for his name. I can tell you that I asked the Lord and I told him that I don't want this privilege, but only when it's over and you came through it victoriously, then I would agree with those courageous believers that I interviewed in the past that it is a privilege to suffer for the name of Christ. When I found out that my home church and many believers in our country as well as abroad were praying for me at a certain time, 8 o'clock in the evening, I understood why I was able to fall asleep at 9 o'clock in the Sudanese prison so easily. 9 o'clock in Sudan at the time was exactly 8 o'clock at home. And it was an amazing encouragement for me to know that people were consistently and faithfully praying for me. We trusted the Lord that he was the one who had the keys from our cell. But when we were able to see how Christians were acting on our behalf, how they were protesting against the regime and for our release in front of the Sudanese embassies in the world, that was extremely encouraging to know. Paul said that we are all parts of one body, and when one part of the body suffers, the whole body feels the pain. VOM's role is to inform the non-persecuted body of Christ about our persecuted brothers and sisters. And when they know about the sufferings and persecution of their brothers and sisters, I'm sure that they will feel the pain. They will start to pray in a more fervent way. They will be more faithful to pray for them. And when they will pray for the persecuted church, the Lord will also show them what they can do, either with their resources or maybe even they can travel personally to encourage brothers and sisters and to help them in a way that the Lord will show them.